Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming out. It is the first Tuesday of the year, and here we are. And what better way to kick off the year? But you didn't come just to see me chat with you, so I have to introduce our good girlfriend, a sister to sisters. Even just now, I'm about to get emotional because she's like, I got you. We sisters. We plan together. And Lisa is a millionaire, right? She is a woman who's created this Abundance Now movement, but not too long ago, she had a little less than $12 in her bank account. But not just the financial part of it, but the emotional part of being emotional bankrupt and rebuilding herself and touching the lives of millions in the process. And so she is a New York Times bestselling author and soon to be second New York Times bestselling author. Support and celebrate the new book. So please get to our feet and help us welcome this incredible, incredible woman, Miss Lisa Nichols. Come on out. Don't act surprised. Of course we came out.
Right.
Well, you know, it's cold, so. You guys sit down. Sit down. Oh, I'm so excited that you guys are here. Hi, Shimon. Hey. Oh, how exciting. Could we have the stool so I can see everyone in the back? Thank you. I want to stand high.
Hello.
Can we stand up? Let's stand up.
And this dress is a stand high dress, right?
Right. And they're going to bring stools so we can see everyone. I've been waiting to see you guys.
And while you're already standing, can you just give them a little bit of this dress moment?
Oh.
Some of these people, you got to show. You can't.
Guys, I'm sorry. Y'all got to just deal with it. But since we are.
Yes.
So, you know, I've been on a journey, and I purchased this dress months ago, and I just put it in the back of the closet. And I just said, on the day my book is released, and I just prayed. I didn't even touch it because, you know, I don't want to stress out. On the day it is released, and I took a photo shoot in it. You guys see one of my Facebook pages in it, but I couldn't say anything. It was one of these. I wasn't really wearing it. I was just in it. I couldn't do anything in it. It was still too tight. Thank you so much. I appreciate it, Caitlin. Now I could see you guys. Thank you so much. There we go. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for the second baby. The second book is here.
Right.
I feel like I have my questions in mark, but I feel like you need to be holding a copy. At some point, we're going to get you a copy too for our
photo. Okay. I know it by heart.
But congrats.
But yes, I can look at it.
Thank you. And such an important message, right? Because we talk about living and surviving, but what you're saying, let's thrive. Let's live our abundant life. So when was the moment you said this was the second book?
Well, you know, it's been a journey, and I like how you, and I want to make sure we go back to the distinction between living, surviving, and thriving, because we think living is okay, because that's the conversation we've taken on. I'm getting by. I'm all right. I'm hanging in there, and that's become our norm, and I want to disrupt. I want to disrupt the norm. I want to disrupt the norm, make us uncomfortable for a moment, and then settle inside of a new norm. How about that? That's my intention. So for the last, 2 years I've been taking my company public? About 2 years. And so just that conversation by itself is, you know, I'm the girl from South Central Los Angeles, born between the Harlem Crip 30s and the Rolling 60s. Those are not cheerleading squads. I'm that kid who got no higher than a C+ in school. So 2 years ago when I was taking my company public and literally filling out the paperwork and kind of going, is this real? And I'm sitting in my office and I'm signing shares and I'm going, this is like Monopoly, man. This can't be real. I begin to jokingly say, I'm the same woman who was on welfare. So I should probably write the book From Welfare to Wall Street. Ha ha. I was just joking. Ha ha. I should write the book from welfare to Wall Street, from public assistance to going public. Ha ha. I kept saying that. And someone said, why don't you quit joking about it and write it? And then I realized that in 155 interviews that I did in 2009, almost every single interviewer asked me the same question, how did you do it? And I kept trying to answer in a soundbite, because that's all the time I had. And I realized if I was really going to bless you, it wasn't going to be in a soundbite. That if I really wanted to show the path, I had to open up the path. And so abundance now was, where did I go and what did I learn? I realized abundant thinkers think differently than average thinkers. And you don't know because you're around a bunch of average thinkers. And so when you stretch out a little bit beyond them, I'm the bomb.com. I'm out in front. But you're just out in front of average thinkers. Mm-hmm. I know. Oh, some parts
tweet
of this
that
nice
hashtag.
Thing. I apologize. Oh, I apologize. I should have, they said that on my books, I should give a caveat on the front of the book. This may require you, this may be given straight, no chaser. Mm. So some of this conversation might sting, but it's with love.
Amen. It's a needed conversation.
Right, and it's the conversation that we needed to have a long time ago, just as humanity, not as women. And I understand, for all the men here, thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. My space is always welcome for men, women, black, white, Asian, Latino, Indian, Latin. I'm clear, I serve humanity. So thank you for coming. I appreciate it. But it's an overdue conversation. And I believe that I'm perfect to have the conversation because I lived in lack and scarcity so long. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
So people always say you have to qualify to have a conversation. And I've lived in wealth, and in my form of wealth. There's some people with wealth who make mine look like it's kibbles and bits, but I like my wealth now, right? And so I looked at both sides and go, oh, what's the difference? What's the difference when I was there? How was I thinking? And when I was here, how was I thinking? So this book just unveils the difference in the thinking. Does that make sense? So if you want what abundant thinkers have, do what abundant thinkers are doing, you have to think like abundant thinkers are thinking. And I decided to share some of that. Anybody interested?
We all interested.
Right. Yes,
yeah, and we definitely will have some time for some questions from the audience. So any questions you have for Lisa, she is definitely open to take them. And just thank you, too, because I've been hearing you talk about this book for months. And so to finally get it last month and to be able to, first of all, it's a meaty read. So you get more than your money's worth. And you get set up to make so much more money because we're shifting how we view our financial resources and the financial assessment you have inside of there. But I want you to talk about that emotional connection we do have to money, to wealth. You talk about Sister Brown in the book and how that connection of to be helping, especially to be a servant, to help people, then how you almost have to be broke. Like, if you have money and wealth, then are you really helping? So talk about how you shifted your mindset that I can serve, I can do good in the world, and I still can be well off as I do it.
Sure. So I'll talk about your money blueprint. You might want to write these down just because it's a mental shift. That it may be a mental shift for you. And while you're getting that, your paper out and your pen out, I just want to acknowledge my team. I didn't do this alone. I don't walk alone. I don't stand alone. I didn't get here alone. So number one, my team back at home motivating the masses. I want to celebrate them. Periscope there back at home. I want to celebrate you guys. Carla is with me from my team. She has been, she's our tour coordinator and making it happen. And then I have the amazing HarperCollins team. You know, to have a book with HarperCollins means a lot, you know, because they are world class and they represent, you know, top notch. But to have the team that I have, I don't know what the other book authors have, but the team that I have is a team of truly committed, dedicated individuals. So Heidi Marie, can you guys stand from HarperCollins? Everyone, Kendra, Michael, Patricia, and Carrie, everyone from Harper.
Thank you.
Come stand up from Harper. Come stand. My entire team and Heidi and Marie over there, I gotta tell you that I was blessed with the team that made it happen, you know, in terms of meeting our energy exactly where we were. People talk about not getting a great deal. I got a great deal because I got a phenomenal team. And I was more committed to what this book could do once it got in people's hands, and I need to get in people's hands. So thank you. Thank you, Carrie, for being my consistent cheerleader and talking me off the wall, you know, and trusting me when I went rogue and have all kind of crazy ideas. Thank you, Michael, for being a stand for all the unique ways that we're putting the books in people's hands. And thank you to my PR team for being an advocate for the message so much that you're beating down doors and getting us booked everywhere. So thank you. So when we look at what are some of the blueprints, we have a money blueprint. And we have a money blueprint that we were born into that we're unconscious to, because it's cultural, it's gender, it's economical, It's geographical. It's not even something you consciously are aware of. It's just what you were born into. Does that make sense? It's like if you love pasta, you probably love it because you were raised eating it. Or if you love cornbread, or if you love a certain kind of music, you were dancing to that music or eating that food before you were even conscious. It just was a part of your culture. Does that make sense, you guys?
Yes.
And so a money blueprint is the exact same way. So I'm going to give you several blueprints that you have that are unconsciously driving you. May I do that?
Okay.
And so what I'm simply going to do, and what I've done in this book, is I brought from your unconscious to your conscious. So now when you respond to it, at least you can consciously be aware, oh, that's what I'm responding to. It has to do with how you spend. It has to do with how you save. It has to do with how your relationship to money. Mm-hmm. It all comes from a blueprint from a long time ago that because no one has caused us to look at it, we haven't. We've just been reacting to it. Does that make sense, you guys? Now, there are people who break out of it. They become aware and they go, no, I want something different. I was one to go, I want to learn what you know. Teach me your blueprint because I'm done with mine. Right? But I have to make a decision to do that. A lot of times you don't know to do that. You just don't like what you have. You just don't, but you don't know how to go get something else because it's in your mind and you can't touch it. It's an unconscious belief system. So there's a culture blueprint that says how your family relates to money is how you were raised to relate to money. Think about that. Now I'm going to trigger some things for you guys. So for some of you guys, you're going to go, ah, and others, you're going to go, ah, because I did that. I was like, whoa, I got to undo, like, thank you so much, mom and grandma, but I need to unlearn that. That doesn't mean I don't love my mom any less, I love my mom any less, or I love my grandmother any less. It just means that I've outgrown that belief system. Does that make sense? And so your money blueprint, and there's blueprints for many things. We're just going to talk about money because that has such a strong energy to it. Money and relationships are the things that we spend the most time talking about, complaining about, hoping for, wishing for, daydreaming about, you know, fussing over, money and relationships. So if those are the two things you can get underway and shift your mindset around, you really can shift the quality of your life before the end of 2016. You really can, but your mindset has to shift because anywhere that your mindset goes, your lifestyle will go. We try to change our habits, but we haven't changed our lifestyle, our mindset. And when you change your mindset, your lifestyle has to follow. When you change your lifestyle without changing your mindset, it's going to be like a rubber band and slingshot back. Example, the people who won the lottery. Slingshot back to broke soon or quick because they didn't change their mindset. They had $20 million. So you have a cultural relationship to money. How your culture related to money. So my culture as an African-American woman, my grandmother could make a dime go in 20 different directions, and she would say that. So I took pride in making a dime go in 20 different directions. Well, what about having 21 dimes and only 20 directions it has to go in? Anybody up for that? Right? Right, but it's such a paradigm shift. It's such a paradigm shift. You almost will spend 19 dimes so you can get back to one dime that has to go in 20 different directions because that's your comfort zone.
Right.
Ouch.
Right.
Ouch.
Ouch. I'm just saying. I mean, you know, sometimes the truth is not served with warm cookies and milk. I'm just saying. So then you look at your gender background. From an early age, men are taught you got to get a good job. Their masculinity is attached to their ability to provide and how much money they make. As a woman, it's get a good job or get a good man with a good job, right? And so there's a pressure for a man to perform in that capacity. There's a pressure for a woman, but it's different. She has to stay, that's the whole image thing, right? And so when a woman wants to stay home, be a stay-at-home mom, she's a matriarch and she's wonderful. A man is like, questionable, because society taught us to think that way. Those are all society taught mindsets. And then you think of economic. How are the economics in your household? If money was argued over, if money was divisive, if money kept your family away, if money kept you in lack, if money made you seem like you weren't as good as the neighbors, the Joneses next door, then you have that relationship to money. If you notice people who've had a lot of tension around money, family stress around money, as an adult you normally say, I don't care about money. But it's an unconscious conversation that says, I care about people more than money, so you have to say, I don't care about money. And so just think about, a lot of the way your relationship to money comes from something way back. And so just begin to look at that. My mother used to say, money burns my pocket. So I thought money was hot, and you couldn't keep any. And so I never wanted to know the balance in my bank account because I knew I'd spend it down until it was zero. Anyone else like that? And then I feel like, oh, now level set, back to normal. That was my unconscious money blueprint driving my behavior. And that's a breakthrough right there, right? Now when you get, oh my God, I keep going back to what my norm is, even though you don't care for your norm. It's the blueprint. And so in the book, I have you look at all the blueprints. Matter of fact, I have you write down what this particular blueprint looks like for you, so you can at least see it and go, okay. And then decide, does that still work for me, or have I outgrown it? And then I have you create an affirmation that changes that blueprint into something that you really want. Anybody want to know what page that's on? Like 58 right there. Go skip past 1 through 57, go straight to page 58, right?
You better know your book
right,
numbers.
Right. So it really is shifting our relationship to wealth. When I was about to make, I made about $975,000 by October years ago, and I took the rest of the year off. I thought it's because I was tired. I'm tired. I worked hard enough. People are like, why are you taking the rest of the year off? Because I'm almost at a million. What'd you do? That was my defensiveness to back them up. Then the next year, I got to $985,000 by August, and I decided to take off. But I had to address, why am I willing to take off 6 months? Because I was afraid to make $1 million in 1 year. Because it didn't make sense with who I knew myself to be, mm-hmm. or my family to be. And more than anything, I kid you guys not, you think I gotta get up.
Get up.
More than anything. So more than anything, we like prosperity, but we love community. Mm-hmm. Community is far more important to us. Our village, our tribe is far more important to us than how much we have in our bank. Especially when you've learned how to manage with less. And so I didn't want to make a lot of money because it made me that much more different than my cousins. Mm-hmm. And so I slowed down. So my question to you is, in what ways are you slowing down? In what ways are you keeping yourself in this range so you don't leave anyone behind? Or so you don't show up looking like the unicorn that you actually are? Right, Emil? Yes. And so that was my thing, that even though money was available to me, I didn't want money as much as I wanted community, and to the point where I was slowing down. So how much wealth and prosperity have you left on the table? Because it would put you in another hemisphere, another atmosphere, another zip code. Or how many opportunities, business opportunities, or what kind of love, or what kind of health and physical wealth, or what kind of spiritual advancement? Our expansion have you stepped away from, because it would make you look like you're too different from the religion that you were raised with. I'm gonna confront everything, because if you're willing to disrupt everything, if you're willing to disrupt all the hard dirt, all the soil, if you disrupt it and you plant a new seed, something new will grow. And I believe that we all have the birthright for abundance. I believe it's not for some people of a certain culture, of a certain hue, of a certain religion, of a certain geographical origin. I believe that abundance is every single one of our birthrights. And I believe it will never come to our front door, delivered by UPS. Here, sign here, I got abundance for you. Mm-hmm. Like, no. It's up to us to go get it. I believe it starts with our mindset.
Absolutely. So, and of course, you shift it, right? First of all, let's give it up for that answer. That was incredible. Thank you, Lisa. And we definitely have all experienced that sometimes wanting to shrink, not to make others around us uncomfortable, not to make those cousins uncomfortable. You clearly got new friends. Steve Harvey did a wonderful forward in the book, and a dear friend, Lisa's on the show, just announcing the new book. But talk about what shifted you to get from not being comfortable making that $1 million to saying, actually, I will own my abundance, and I will step into right. my own prosperity.
Well, it's simple. It's more work to shrink. It just, anybody tired of shrinking? Like, I'm just checking. It's more work to shrink. You're constantly, I was constantly managing where can I go versus just going, how about I just soar and see how far I could go? I was more consumed with other people's perception of me than I was committed to my own thoughts about myself at one time. And I just decided, wait a minute. My grandmother said, other people's perception of me ain't none of my business. So how about I just let you have your thoughts and then I just do me? How about I see how big I can play? How about I remember that I don't want to get to the end of my life and say I played at 70% just so I could be liked. That I want to play at 159%. When I rest in peace, I want to be tired. Like, I just got really clear with the story that I want to tell about my life. I want to say I played full out. And I knew I wasn't playing full out, but I knew my 70% looked like someone else's 159. Anybody? Okay, so let me just show you the guidelines. When I say something, y'all not gonna put me out here by myself. Y'all know. How many of y'all know how I operate?
Yes,
so
yes.
So when I say something that sounds guilty, you say what?
Yes, yes.
Right, and when you know it's you, you put one hand up, or two hands up, or two hands up. Y'all don't just let me stand here by myself
and
do the work.
I'm sorry, I didn't prepare.
I am not doing the work all by myself. Y'all just hiding. Carrie, they trying to make it seem like they don't know any better. Y'all know better. Y'all know about this whole book. I've been saying this to you guys, right? So I want to hear you so that you hear your truth. It's not even for me. It's so that you hear your truth. Like, if I had it my way, January 5th will be the day something turned for you. Mm. It will be the day that it became mildly to moderately to significantly uncomfortable for you to play a mediocrity. It became so uncomfortable for you to shrink one more time. It felt like a size 10 foot in a size 7.5 shoe. Mm. Like, my prayer
for you
is that January 5th is that day for you.
Yes.
So I'm not looking for your comfort. I'm looking for your breakthrough inside your discomfort. Mm. Right? Because if you want to know, my life transformation didn't come with the ceiling opening up and lights coming down and song. Oh, oh. Like, I've been partying for New Year's, so I still ain't got my voice back. Right, I brought the sun up, y'all. Good Lord. Right, breakfast. Right, y'all been on Periscope, watching me on Periscope. Right. I had 31 people spend a night at my house because the party just would not stop. Right. So your breakthrough doesn't come with the ceilings opening and light beaming down. It comes because you get so uncomfortable inside your current norm that your future requires you to stretch beyond your comfort zone. Everything you want, everything you need, everything that's the next level for you is on the other side of your comfort zone. My grandmother says your comfort and your conviction and your convenience don't live on the same block.
Say that one more time.
Your comfort and your conviction and your convenience don't live on the same block. Never have, never will. They're not even in the same zip code. So a lot of times we're trying to expand our life to a new level without being inconvenienced. We're trying to keep it a secret. I'm going to grow, but I'm not going to tell nobody in case it don't work. Come on, you guys. Yes, yes. Come on, you guys. Yes, yes. Right. Your biggest goals are the ones you say the quietest, right? I just exposed somebody, right? Right? Right. And so what does it take for you to have enough faith in yourself to say it loudly?
Mm.
To risk big. If you're going to fall, fall big. And then if you fall and you hit the ground, get a Band-Aid and get up. Yeah. You act like you can't get up again. Abundance now is simply a repeat act over and over and over and over again until I got it somewhat right. I'm still learning how to get it right. Like, the book tells you about my crash and burns, but you get excited about the crash and burn because you know on the other side is a get up. Like, so why are we so afraid to fall? In the book I say, if you're afraid to fail, then you will never fly because you will never leave the ledge because you're more committed to being safe than you are to flying. And the last thing you want is in your final days to sit and say, I sure was safe. Who wants to hear that story? They don't even want to write that story. All right? Right? You don't want to write that story. You don't want to tell that story. And so right now, you got everything in your fiber and your being to play big. Yes, you might fail. But abundant thinkers, when they fail forward. This morning, who was on Periscope with me this morning? I said I interviewed online with, what's his name? Roland, look there, everybody know. I was on television, Roland Martin, and I could not get out abundancenowonline.com. It was too much to send people to that. And I only figured out while I was doing it live, so I failed epically. And I said that on Periscope. I said, guys, so three things I did well was, and I did my three things I did well, I said two areas I need to improve in is I need to get another URL. Because that was a mouthful. So as of now, people can go and join me at Join Lisa Free. Right. Hello. I told y'all it was going to happen. This morning I said I'm going to get another URL that's easier to say. So now it's Join Lisa Free. So now on my next show, when I do it again tomorrow or sometime, I'm going to say now you can join me free at Join Lisa Free. Right. And so The abundant thinkers fail. All day long we fail. But we fail forward. We fail forward. And so can you give yourself permission to play really big in 2016 at the risk of failing? Matter of fact, can you give yourself permission in 2016 to fail? Like, think about it. Because if you say, if I fail, it's all right. Now you're really going to play big. Yeah. Like, that's when it gets good. It gets sweet. I've been claiming a bestseller since we started writing the book, right, Carrie? Mm-hmm. I've been saying, bestseller, bestseller. And then I go home and go, okay, I got to make this a bestseller. Because if I fail, everybody heard about it on Periscope, on YouTube, on Facebook, on the Steve Harvey Show, everybody. But, you know, play big or go home. Mm. I want to say I played big today. And so, I have no idea what question we at, but amen.
Yes, yes.
And she knew I was going to do this. She was like, Lisa, I'm just going to talk and get out your way.
Okay. Yeah, I'm saying, come to
amen.
Stage.
Amen.
But obviously, you look phenomenal. Congrats on the book. And you're standing in the vision. This is a bestseller. And we're all in this room committed to that being our reality.
Yes. Like, it wasn't even like a question of doubt.
Yes, yes.
It's like automatically, once I found out you were coming out, I was like automatically a bestseller. Like I just, it's already, it's done.
Mm. Claim it. Claim yes. it.
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes.
And part of the abundance you've generated in your life in which you're guiding us on that journey is we have to create space for this abundance. So
yes.
You talked about in 2016, a lot of us might have just made it here from a busy job, leaving in a few minutes. We live in a time where our lives are already so full with non-abundant things. So talk about your journey of releasing things, situations in your life to create space for your abundance, but also how we can create space for that abundant life on top of and all the things we have going on now to make a little space for it.
Absolutely. So I love it when people say, I just need more time in the day. Because you know that'll never happen, so that's a sexy excuse you get to keep. Like, we're sneaky, you guys, because we're brilliant. Like, you got to watch out for yourself, especially if you're smart. If you're not smart, don't worry about it. You're not going smart, you got to watch out for yourself because your excuses are so sexy, you start believing that they're real. Like, if I just had more hours than that, you know no one's going to give you more hours in the day. You will never get 26 and a half. I've been praying for that for years. It does not happen, right? And so, number one, when you think, what do I need to release? The first thing I'm always going to say is, what conversations are you having that doesn't serve you? Because it's easy to say, I need to release this person, but what conversations? I write in the book that every phrase after the word I am are true to your unconscious mind. Every word after the phrase I am are true to your unconscious mind. Your unconscious mind cannot determine if you say I'm stupid or I'm brilliant. It can't determine which one. It treats both as if it's true. So number one, feed yourself a better conversation. Feed yourself, because I'm going to watch you as the example of how I get to treat you. You are the first example of how the world gets to treat you. I said that when I was on Oprah in 2007. She says, that's the exact same thing I say. I said, well, I'm saying at least one thing right. Oprah say that, then I know I'm on the right track. But you are the first example of how the world gets to treat you. So how are you treating yourself? Out loud and privately. See, we have to be careful because we're brilliant. It's not what we say when people are watching. It's what we say in the mirror to ourselves or without moving our lips. It's what we say in the dark of the night. So when we talk about release, when you say release, I'm gonna say release the toxic mindset and conversation that hasn't served you, that you don't even like, that doesn't fit in your 2016. It doesn't fit. Right. So that's number one. And number two, be willing to release habits. You know, I was sitting with someone the other day and some of you saw them on Periscope. It was an old friend from about 30 years ago. And he just had some behaviors that just were suspect. And I said, does that really work for you? He goes, well, that's how I've always been. I said, oh, okay. So you still get to choose. Like, you're not sentenced to a future because it was your past. Your past does not create your future. Your past is exactly that. Your future is created by your now. Think about that. Now, it might be a habit because you're used to it, but it doesn't mean that you have to continue doing it if it doesn't work for you. I'm always late. No, every moment you choose to be late. Mm. Like, that's just the truth. Every moment you choose to be late. And that, just call it that. Don't sentence yourself to it. Own it. Own every part. You're an active participant. You are the star of the show called you. And that's the good news, is that at any given scene, you get to change the backdrop. Any given scene, you get to change the backdrop. So that's the second thing to release, is habits and behaviors that don't serve what you say you want to do. Because when you say you want to do something and your behaviors are different, I want you to see what I'm about to do. The tongue in your mouth is going this way, and the tongue in your shoe is going this way. And it's like this. And you wonder why you don't move. Mm. Well, it's because it's almost like you're about to jump in a double dutch. You keep rocking back and forth and rocking back, and you go, why am I still here? Because the tongue in your mouth and your tongue in your shoe are going in two different directions. Mm. Ouch. I love y'all. This is a good time to say I love you. So the book is meant for transformation. Does that make sense, you guys? The book is a deep dive that you work in. You live in it. You work out of it. You come back to it. When I was writing the book, I was channeling my favorite book on the planet. I read when I was 25 years old. It changed my life, and that was Seven Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. I talk about it. When Jack Canfield interviewed me for the 50 best books people have read, he interviewed 50 people that he really respected, and he asked me what was the book. I only can choose one book. I chose that book because it created the most shift in my life. I've read hundreds of books since then, but that book created the most shift in my life. I could live out of it. I can grow out of it. I can aspire to be like the book. Does that make sense? I wrote Abundance Now on that premise. So it's not a pick up and put down. It is, you got to live in it. You got to digest it. You got to breathe in between, as you can tell from the conversation. Now, the last thing that I invite you to release is release people who don't fit in your future. And I don't necessarily mean you have to release them like don't speak to me anymore, but you decide the distance that you love them from. You just decide the distance, because sometimes you're so adamant of trying to pull people along at a pace they don't even want to be pulled along at. You're trying to save them and they didn't ask to be saved. Yes. You're trying to convert, oh, that's it. Woo. You're trying to you're trying to convert them, and there's nothing wrong with them to them. You went off and read a self-development book, and now you want to rescue them. They didn't ask you to rescue them. And don't tell them all the stuff I said and make them not like me. Don't be like, oh, you, Lisa, you why my wife keep trying to make me come to a workshop. Right? Love them right where they are. Choose them every day right where they are. Choose them every day. Retire from the converting business. Repeat after me. I retire.
As of today.
From the converting business. Because I really, really.
Suck at it.
Like, you haven't successfully converted anybody. Like, think about it. You are literally 0 for 100, right? I know I am. So the day I retired, I was like, life is so much easy now that I can just love you where you are. We get along better. You like having me around. I like being around, because I'm going to leave you right there. My cousins, let me tell you, it was just holidays. My cousins, we're all around, and they'll just be complaining and I got all kinds of solutions for them. I just be sitting there eating some sweet potato pie, chatting. It feels good. I'm not working, and they're not being worked on. It's a win-win. Yes. And so don't try to bring everyone with you at that pace. But there's a chapter in the book that says, don't leave your tribe behind. Mm-hmm. I say, and I'm going to say tonight, if you got one book, I'm going to ask you to go get another one. Mm. Right. I'm going to ask you to go get another one. I've been saying that for the longest. We've already made the bestsellers list. I've already got the advance. It's not about me. It's about your tribe being fed what you're being fed. It's about you sitting it down. It's about you sitting down your tabbed version and then picking up the other one, because I'll go right to somebody else's tab. I'm like, what inspires her? Right? I tab 2 books at a time. I've already tabbed 4 books in my house, and I just sit them around. And guaranteed, my drunk cousins were sitting around on New Year's Day. They were still drunk from the night before. But they're like, Lisa, this some good stuff, girl. You might be the real deal after all. Right? Well, let me tell you, when I was on Oprah for The Secret, I came home, and they're like, we're mad at you. I said, why? They said, because you keeping secrets. I was like, no, it's a book. I was like, I gave all y'all a copy. They was like, oh, girl, I got that sitting under my plant, because it was lopsided. Right. You leave them right where they are. You love them right where they are, right? And so I'm gonna invite you to bring your tribe along. Don't just get one book. Invest in someone else's breathtaking future. The book that changed my life was gifted to me. It was gifted to me. And it was the beginning of a whole new reality. And so I'm gonna boldly say, don't walk by yourself. Bring someone along who's interested. Bring someone who's looking for a brighter day and don't quite know how to get there. because their aha could also be their breakthrough, could be their shift. And so,
open it for questions. Right back here.
How do you avoid stepping on toes?
That's a great question. What's your name?
Ralph.
Ralph. So Ralph, it's it's serving the truth. It's serving the truth. It's the difference between serving the truth on a trash can top or on sterling silver. So often it's not necessarily the truth that steps on toes, it's how we serve it. And so I'm gonna invite you, stay in your truth, but serve your truth as if you were on the receiving end. I have difficult conversations all the time and I'm quite comfortable with them, but I tell my team and my son, have every conversation with one intent, to keep their dignity intact. Anytime you threaten their dignity, find a new way to say it. And being a responsible communicator is not just being responsible for what you say, but it's being responsible for how it lands. That's the ultimate form of communication. So Ralph, I say, tell the truth. But tell the truth in the space of how it's gonna land, not how you need to say it all the time.
Yes, yes. Yes. Any other questions?
If there are other questions, I can bring you a microphone so everybody can hear them. So just raise your hand and I'll.
And also, she's one of our beat time inkers.
I remember. I remember the two of you.
Hi.
How are you guys doing?
We're engaged now.
Yay! Congratulations.
Abundance now.
Abundance now.
Yes,
engagement
yes.
Engagement now. Marriage now.
Guess what she said, Lisa? She said yes, yes.
Yes, she said yes, yes.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi, sweetheart. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Wonderful.
So nice to see you. Thank you for being here.
You're welcome. It's nice to see you again.
I'm going
to
ask you the question again. I'm sure I asked it before, but what was the transformational moment that got you here?
That got me here in terms of in my life, or got me here in terms of
what was when did your life change and how? What was the spark?
Right. So you know, I love when I get that question because I keep trying to search for the moment.
It's here, Lisa.
And it's it's all in the book. That's my cue to say it's in the book. You got to get the book. But I already know you guys are going to get it. I already know that. It wasn't a moment for me. It was a number of moments. So the launch moment was when I didn't have money to put Pampers on my son. That was when I was sick and tired of my story. So that was the bottom line why that I still can't say without crying. I'm done. I'm done. I'm bankrupt with this story. I don't want to be here anymore. So it was just that. So all motivation doesn't come wrapped in a big red bowl. Some of your best motivation will come wrapped in sandpaper. And it's your relationship to it that's going to determine how far you go. Some of the things that have held you down the most, that have been the darkest hour, that was the thing meant to be your soil. Manure ain't never smelled good, and yet it grows some of the best things from it. But it's the way you relate to me. If you don't plant a seed in manure, it's just gonna stink. I'm just saying. Right, I should have put that in the book. That's bonus. And then there were pivotal moments. There were pivotal moments, you know. So when you look at here, a publicly held company, that took a lot for me. I just went through that 2 years ago. And I am going to spotlight you. You don't have a choice. This gentleman right here, Shimon, would you please raise your hand, stand up? Would you please stand up? He has held my hand the whole way. And was the shoulder I cried on? Was the safe space that I decide I can't do it? Was the cheerleader for me? And, you know, God would put us together. And when you look at us, we probably wouldn't be hanging out. Well, he would be hanging out at some place I'd hang out. That's the coolest man, you know. I know eating kosher. yes, yes. That's my guy.
Lisa, I would love for you to talk a little bit about that decision. And you talk about it in the book, but you are the first, one of the trailblazers of a publicly traded motivational speaking company. So talk about doing something that you've not seen been done before and stepping into that space.
So I'm the only public company in the self-development industry now. There have been others, but they're not there anymore. And one of two African-American women who founded a company that has gone public. And it's been a journey. I think I've grown more. Oh, now y'all gotta get the tissue. I've grown more in the last 2 years than I've grown probably in the last five. because Wall Street and the conversation of going public is not about a fan base. It's about business. It's about straight business, the viability of a scalable business. And thank you so much, sis. I appreciate it. You open that for me. And I went public, you know, some people disagree with it. And I'm okay because I'm not looking for people to validate my choices. I made the choice that I felt like I needed to make. I've learned some really, really great lessons that came really hard. And by the grace of God, I've had some great partners to help navigate me through those that tough terrain. Because it's a different climate. But I went public because, one, my company has grown double digits every year for the last 10 years. And our biggest challenge is funding our growth. And if I got to pick my problems, I'm going to pick that problem all day long. And so we wanted to financially infuse our growth so that we weren't continuing to build it on duct tape, bubblegum, band-aids, and shoestring. That's number one. And number two, believe it or not, I wanted to go public because I'm the same woman that was on public assistance. And for every entrepreneur behind me, what would it do? What would it make possible? What can you see now? What happens now? What happens now when you go from there to there? Because you know, in 1984, when Valerie Briscoe Hooks broke the world record for the 220-yard dash, four people came behind her: Evelyn Ashford, Flo Jo, and Jackie Joyner. Three people. And all three of those ladies broke the world record chasing Valerie Briscoe Hooks. Y'all get it yet?
Yeah.
And so I figured, if I go through this door, as scary as it is, guys, and I would love to tell you it ain't scary today, but it still gets, but I'm okay. I do things with my knees knocking and my teeth chattering. See, fear is not your enemy. Fear is your friend. Allowing fear to paralyze you makes fear your enemy. Fear keeps you awake. Fear makes you get up early. Fear makes you do your homework. Fear humbles you out. Fear has you ask for help. Fear is your friend if you use it as your fuel. So every time I get nervous, I go, what is it that I don't know that I'm worried about that's making me afraid? And I go find that answer. Does that make sense, you guys?
Yes.
So I embrace it. And so, yeah, I get nervous. I mean, we're out talking to investors now, and like they're not saying yes, yes. They don't look like y'all. Shimon will tell you that. They're not coming in raving fans. I think by the time they leave, they like me at some point. But it's a business decision. And if you can take a dream and make it a viable business on Wall Street, you have a business. And that validates all of us.
Absolutely. Thank you. I don't think you need a tissue anymore. But so much of this book, you know, of course we talked about financial, the money, but so much of this and so much of the reason we're in this room is the relationship component. You talk about the 12 pillars or categories where we can have abundance in relationships is heavy in that presence. So many people in this room are people you've personally been in relationships with, and your team is incredible. I never see Lisa without an incredible woman who, if she left the room, could still run the show. And so talk about the power of relationships in our abundance now, and Absolutely. Also how we build those partners.
Absolutely. So first let me give you the three myths to abundance, and you might want to write these down. Here are the three myths about abundance. So one myth is that abundance is for, I said it earlier, it's for some people, not everyone. That's one myth. Abundance is for everyone. It's just that, and once you have the truth, don't go back to the myth. Don't go back to the lie. Don't vacillate between the lie and the truth. Just understand, once you know the truth, know the truth. And whenever you begin to live like you don't know the truth again, you've unlearned the truth. Okay, so let me just take away the myths. So abundance is for some people. That's one myth. That's not true. The second myth is that abundance is singularly focused. It's finances and it's possessions. That's the second myth. That when we look at wealthy people or abundant people, we look at their homes, we look at their cars, we look at their clothes. We have so much in media now making you defining what abundance is for you. That's not abundance, you guys. That's wealth. Let me tell you the difference between wealth is financial, abundance is holistic. I want you to understand that distinction. Wealth is financial, abundance is holistic. Abundance has four key categories. There's 12 categories when you break them down in a smaller component, but four groups. One is your self-awareness. The way you love yourself, the way you treat yourself has everything to do with your abundance. How many of us know that we've passed up something really great because we didn't think we were worthy of it? Raise your hands up high, not shy. Great, look around. That has everything to do with your level of abundance and how it's showing up in your life. The second area of abundance is in your relationships. At the end of your days, you will measure the quality of your life by the quality of your relationships. You will actually forget more about the other ones. You'll look at who's around you in your senior years. You'll look at who's there to care for you. That's how you measure it. We talk about being alone, right? So that's two. The third area is the quality of your spirituality and how you can ground, how you can release, how you can forgive, how you can let go, how you can be still, how you take deep breaths. Most of us don't think about that when we get away from that, especially if we've had religious challenges. But the quality of your life will have a lot to do with the quality of your spiritual grounding. Whatever you call your God, however you worship, finding a place to release, finding a way to forgive fast, finding a way to be still, finding a way to let go. That will determine greatly the quality of your life. And then looking at your finances. Notice I put that last. It's not because it's the least important, but it's not the most important. I have very wealthy friends who are very, very unhappy. And some of you saw them on Periscope. They had nowhere to go for New Year's. So, you know, I bring the whole party, everybody. You need to go somewhere, come to my house. Because they've built, amassed billions, not millions, but billions of dollars in net worth. But their relation-wise, they're bankrupt. So they're wealthy, they're not abundant. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So when you look at, and then the third myth, I'm over 40, I'll get back to it. Like, this is just true. It's going to come. It's just on the slope. Well, it's going to come back. Well, I'm going to interrupt myself, and I'm going to tell you what the third myth is. So when we look at relationships, and I spend a lot of time in the book on relationships. I give you self-work around relationships. I give you healing work around relationships. You guys know when I'm working with you live, those of you who I'll begin to work with live, I'm always having you man your relationships. Heal your relationships and up-level your relationships. The first relationship is with yourself. Because the way you treat yourself is the way you're going to treat other people. And many times you'll treat other people better than you treat yourself. How many of us are doing that? Right, and so if I begin to serve others, not from my cup, but I begin to serve you from my overflow, meaning I've taken care of me first, and now I'm taking care of you from my overflow, now I take care of you with a greater heart. And so relationship to self, relationship to others. I promise you, at the end of the day, what matters to you most is what he thinks, what she thinks, what your children think, what your siblings, how they feel about you, who's going to be around, who's loving you, how they're loving you. That's what matters. Money, that's secondary. That money is a tool to give you access to great memories. Right? Money is a tool to give you access to great memories. What I love most about my money is that it bought the opportunity for my son to stand on top of one of the tallest mountains in Kenya and stretch his arms at age 10 with no front teeth and say, "Mommy, I'm on top of the tallest mountain in Africa." That's what I love. That's what I'm excited about. My money bought that experience. That my money bought the experience of my son and I surfing in Brisbane, Australia in May. And yes, I got on the surfboard for a hot second. I love the fact that money allowed my son and I to jump out of a plane together. I don't care. The money, great, but the memories, far more important. So everything will go back to your relationships. Yes, taking grandma on the road with me. You guys saw money allowed me to take grandma on the road. That's all. It's just the access. My 86-year-old grandmother disrupting Jamaica. Y'all saw her? Lord.
Yes, yes.
Jamaica will never be the same after that 86-year-old. Right. Snack, lunch.
This is such a good time. We are, of course, coming down to our last few minutes. I know. Was there one? Rakia, one last? Yes.
Incoming. And then can we just get one more question from a man? Just because the women won't even notice that y'all didn't get to talk that much. Yes.
Question for you. Thank you. And yes. This is my first introduction to you. Thank you, Charreah, for inviting a bunch of people, including me. As you are building, and you, not just you, the collective you, building your abundance and your wealth, how do you navigate helping others? So your cup is not running over yet. You're working on that. But you see, either from family or close friends, the need for your assistance. What do you do then?
So are you asking the question, how do you bring your family and friends along with you?
No, they need something very specific from you. Either, well, I think I'm thinking more about wealth and abundance, so I'll be more specific. So if you're trying to build
your own... When you're saying you mean I?
Yes, me.
Yes, okay.
Okay, so as I'm trying to build my wealth, if family or close friends need assistance, how do you specifically determine when to help and when not to, when you know that you could, but it's not
right.
Your cup isn't running over yet.
Right. And this was a hard lesson for me.
That's why I'm asking.
Right. This was really difficult for me because I have a very close family, and my family doesn't ask me for much, actually, very little. And I actually hear more about something going on, and I go, rescue, 911. So that was a part of me as well. Anybody else, let me know I'm not alone. Okay, I just want to make sure, okay.
Yes.
So that was one thing, is that they didn't even have to ask. But I had to get to the root of why I was running so much and spending so much on my family. And what I found out for me was that I felt guilty that I was doing so well. Anybody ever have that feeling?
Yes.
Okay, I felt guilty that I was in the top 1% income earners and my cousin was in danger of losing her home. I felt guilty that they're robbing Peter to pay Paul, and I haven't talked about Peter or Paul in a long time. I felt guilty that they hadn't taken a vacation in years and that I was taking three. So I made up a story. And then I attached an emotion to it called guilt. And then I reacted to the emotion by giving way beyond my comfort zone. So it really had nothing to do with them. If you realize, we really do create the story. The story feels real. Now, the other side to that is when they ask. So what I began to do was I would have a certain amount allocated for my family support every year. And I would let people know. Not when they asked, but when they did ask, I said, okay, so I have an account, and when the account is empty, the account is empty. And they didn't run up and everyone didn't drain it out, because that's not how my family is. But when I say the account was empty, because I created a system. So create a system so you're not having to make the decision every single time. And I also realized that when someone crosses my line in the sand, it's because my line wasn't deep enough. Again, it has less to do with them. And so I set boundaries and parameters around it. I let people know that I'm buying my future and my future cost. I'm buying my freedom, I'm buying my next level, and it costs. So I'm paying for something with this money. This money is pre-invested. And then I have an amount allocated, so I don't hear myself saying no all the time. And when someone asks for $1,000, I'll say, I can give you $600 of that, because I want them to get their hustle on.
Right.
I had to hustle. I had to figure it out. No, I couldn't go to anyone when I was building. So while they do have access to me, still go out and exercise your muscle of asking multiple times. And then I had to learn when people kept themselves in a pattern, when they lived in chaos. They always went around the block and got right back to chaos again. And I said, are you interested in understanding your pattern? Because I'm happy to give you it this time, but if I don't see new behaviors, I can't keep funding your chaos. And so I had difficult conversations laced in love. And I've kept every relationship with every family member that I've had to say no to. Because of the way, how I said it, to Ralph's point, how I said it. I see you thinking, your brain is going like...
Well, I'm just wondering, has that been your policy the whole time? Like, even when you were building, was this your policy? Or is that what your policy is now?
No, I was blessed enough when I was building, my family knew how broke I was. And they did. They knew how broke I was, and they saw my sacrifice. I shared with them, not in a way of, look at me, I'm sacrificing, but I shared with them my dreams. And I ate beanies and weenies 6 days a week. And my family would try to give me money and food. And I go, no, no, no. This okay, my son, we're cool. And so when I started turning around, like, they were in tears. They're like, no, matter of fact, they're very protective of me to go, no, she worked that hard for that. Let her. So they held a different space for me and protected me so they can watch. My son's father went to prison when he was 8 months old. So I had the stigma of a son's father in prison. I had the challenge of a son whose father's in prison and how my son now feels and the anger that he had to go through. So there was so much around me that when I start winning, no one wanted to get in the way of that. No one wanted to stifle that. And they ran into hard times, and I offered to help. And at times they were like, no, cousin, you worked hard for that. Keep that. Like, I pushed to, I had to work with my guilt. Like, it was really about more of my guilt of doing so well and minimizing, shrinking my light because I don't want to outshine my family. And my family were, it was different for them. So, and then after a while, I had to say, I'll never build my personal wealth if I keep giving it all away. Because I built wealth for my company. See, there's three forms of money. You guys might want to write this down. There's how to make money, how to keep money, and how to grow money. Three very different techniques, right, Shimon? Like, he's smiling. I learned something. He's smiling. He's like, look at him smile. Like, she's done good. You've done good by me, my child. Right? That's a proud brother. So, how to make money? Like, how many of us know how to make money? We go out. We know to hustle. That's the first thing you learn. How to keep money is the next piece. How do you really keep money? And then the next sheet baby said, how to grow it. She knows. She, and the last is, how do you grow it? That's the road less traveled. And so I began to share with my family, I'm learning this. And so I took them along the journey intellectually so that they go, how are you doing? Are you keeping it? Yeah, I'm keeping it by saying no to you too. like I told them as I was learning, you know, because I would make a lot and I would give away a lot. And at the end of the year, I was level set, led a wonderful year, had a wonderful nice vacation, but had no savings for years. And then I realized I owe it to my son to keep some wealth. A man before? Oh, yes.
Hi, thanks so much.
You're welcome. What's your name?
Tom.
Hi, Tom.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So I'm curious about your experience as a parent. And what would you say is maybe the most important thing you learned from your experiences?
That's parenting. A great question. And I'll start with this. I was in the car one day after a trip, and my son, Jelani, was sitting next to me. He was about 11. And I had just come off the road, and I was beating myself up silently in my head while we were driving. I'm such a bad parent. Anybody do that? I have too much time in my business. I'm going there. And we're just listening to music and I'm beating myself up and really feeling myself getting sad because I missed him so much and I didn't know what he had done this last week because he had been with his grandparents. And right as I think was about to open my mouth to apologize to him, my son looked at me, and you know, age 11, 12, they kind of, they're free for all. They're not like five, like they think you're the best thing since sliced wheat bread. You know, at age 12, it's like, take it or leave it, right? So I'm kind of worried about, you know, what's coming out of his mouth these days. And he looks at me and he goes, Mom, I want to be like you when I grow up. And I said, you want to speak? He went, oh, no. He goes, but I want to make people feel good. I just want to make people feel good. And so I found, Tom, that my son had basic needs. And I discovered those basic needs. And I'm going to give you something to do. How many children do you have? You don't have any. Okay, great. Are you thinking of having some? Okay, great. You're going to be a phenomenal father. Come on, you guys. Give him some love just by asking this question. I'm gonna give you a question, and everyone else, if you feel courageous, you'll ask this question. I'm gonna give you a question that I discovered when my son was 8, and it's done everything to save my relationship, and not just save it, but to grow it, to make it thrive, to make it meaningful. But I would always feel guilty, and so I began to ask Jelani. I said, son, on a scale from 1 to 10, And ask your love relationships this as well. If you are courageous and you have to do it right, you guys, promise you're going to do it right? Put your pinky up and do print. Okay. Don't do it wrong. And I'm going to tell you what wrong looks like. So I asked my son on a scale from 1 to 10, 10 being the relationship is immaculate, perfect, no need for adjustments. How would you rate our relationship? Now, to do it wrong is if they say anything other than a 10, you have a reaction. That's wrong, you guys, because they can never be honest with you again. You've made it dangerous to be honest with you, especially if you react to a child. Last thing he wants is to make his parent upset, right? So I asked my son, Jelani, on a scale from 1 to 10, how do you rate our relationship? And I'm thinking, I'm doing a great job. We have fun together. And he said, I rated a 7. The next question is the key question. I said, what would take it from a 7 to a 10? Whatever number they give you, the next question is, what would take it from that number to a 10? And that's your homework for 6 months. That's it. Everything else, don't worry about it. Just do that thing so that they can see the difference. So I asked my son, what would take it from a 7 to a 10? Holding back the tears, but making sure he didn't see them at all. And he goes, when you go places that I can't call you, I want to go with you. So I had an opportunity to be outrageous, Tom. I took him out of public school, put him in a private school, and I told the principal, I said, when I travel abroad, when I go international, I'd like to distance learn Jelani, and you send homework with him, and we'll FedEx the homework back. She goes, Ms. Nichols, we don't have that program. I said, oh, great. I'm excited to co-create it with you. I'm excited. And afterwards, you can take all the credit for it. And for the next 4 years, that's exactly what we did. That's how my son stood on top of the tallest mountain in Africa and with his arm stretched because he went to Africa with me. And so the answer to that is be willing to reinvent. Reinvent how parenting looks for you. Take the best practices and then reinvent. Jelani traveled with me for 4 years. I distance learned him. Did he miss a couple of geography classes? I'm sure he did. But he was in Croatia, right? He was in Croatia doing geography. And so I was willing to redefine it for him. I was willing to ask him, and every 6 months, I ask my son the same question on a scale from 1 to 10. How would you rate this? So now Jelani's 21. So we're sitting on the couch literally a year ago, and our feet are touching, and we're watching a marathon of Law and Order, right? Because I want to be a superhero and get the bad guy. It's just my life. And so, right? And so we're touching feet. We just had lunch together. He just cooked me lunch. He went to culinary school, so he learned how to cook really well. And so he cooked me this gourmet lunch, and then we sat down. We had this marathon. So I said, Jelani, on a scale from 1 to 10. He goes, Mom, really? He's 20, right? When he says, Mom, really? You've been doing this for like 10 years. I was like, well, actually it's been 12. But on a scale from 1 to 10, how would you rate our relationship? He said, a 9.5. I said, and what would take it from a 9.5 to a 10? He goes, Mom, really? It's a 9. I said, and what would take it from, he goes, really? We're on the couch, our feet are touching. I just cooked you lunch and we're watching marathon. It's really a 10, but it's freaky telling your mom it's a 10. He goes, it's just bizarre, Mom. I just feel weird saying it's a 10. He goes, but it is a 10. And so I would recommend, Tom, to stay inside that. Keep exploring. Keep exploring and let their voice matter.
So. Well, Lisa Nichols, you are a 10 to us as well. Thank you so much.
That's the closing.
That's it. That's it. There'll be some book signing going on. Thank you to The Strand for allowing us on the team for Beat at
Time
Inc.
Our pleasure. Thank you guys so much for being here.
Where am I going to sign your books at?
Yes, that is important information. Lisa will be sitting back here at this table. We're going to pull this out of the way. So I'm going to ask you guys to get in line, just sort of running down
this
aisle.
Okay, but before you move, can I just do this? Because I disrupt environments. Just if I never get invited back, oh well, but invite me back. So I'm a teacher. Can you guys just give me one aha, just a couple of people, give me one aha that you got from this? Because it's not enough for you just to buy the book. I want you to get an aha. Is that all right? So just give me one aha. So, sir, could you go first? Because I love your energy. You have been giving me great energy the whole time, so thank you. And then if this lady will go, and then, yes, if you go. Just one aha that you got, that you, a nugget you get to take away. Wait, where, can you have the mics?
Thank you.
Wait, get in the mic. I'm getting that mic. Right.
I'm Ellie.
Hi, Ellie.
From the Bronx.
You? Hi, Ellie from the Bronx.
I'm really honored to be sitting here in this room with everybody and you.
Thank you.
I've learned so much. And two nuggets that I'm taking home with me, actually. I got two pockets, and I'm going to put one in each. One about the relationship that I'm going through with my children right now, which has been particularly trying on a lot of levels. And I'm, for the first time in my life, going to ask them about, you know, how far I am from being a 10 to them. You know,
and what would make it a 10?
I think they're going to be, they're at 10 right now, man. It's how far I'm, you know,
right.
It's the distance that, so that's one thing. And then I think I'm going to ask that to my wife as well.
Mm. Yeah. You know, and the second question is the key. The second question is, how do I go from a, whatever the number is, to a 10 for you? That second question gives you all the information you need.
It's the best way to start off the new year. Thank you so much, Lisa.
You're welcome. Thank you for being with me for the new year. What's your aha?
My aha is comfort, conviction, and convenience don't live on the same block.
Come on, you guys.
Even the same.
All right. All right. And right here.
How to make money, how to keep money, how to grow money. I've been stuck at one, but no more.
Right. All right. All right. I just want to make sure, because, you know, as a teacher, I want to know. I came to plant some seeds for you guys. I'm going to sign. I'm going to hug. I'm going to love on y'all. We're going to take some fast pictures. So come ready. Don't come with your purse and your phone and your purse and want a picture and you're not ready. Be ready. Have somebody ready. Do you get your selfie ready? You guys ready? All right. If you ready.